haven't fixed this slide, but it is wrong. The tricky stuff is here. It's not the functional programming. Just figuring out carefully what you want to do. And at the moment, these slides are. I'm giving this presentation using Ubuntu as the because X works well on Linux distributions. But it means that the slides are PDFized from my original PowerPoints and are therefore thoroughly unmalleable, so I can't change them on the fly, as I would otherwise do. But the long and short of it is that when we want to move the focus from this guy at the end right back around here without changing, we want to leave this guy at the front of the list. So we want to really take all of, if this guy is empty, we need to take all of these chaps, which starts with R, and we need to pick the last one. So what we need to do is reverse all of these guys, pick the last one, so you could do case reverse of this lot, pick the last one, and then slap them all on the right here. So I'm not going to, I think our time would best be used by pressing on regardless, and I'll make sure it's right in the slides that finally end up on the web. Let me just, a couple of people asked me about the data type that I introduced here. So data types are a major feature of Haskell, algebraic data types, and they take a single form, but that can look very different in different contexts. So the one I just showed you is that a stack of W is muck stack of list of W and list of W. So these are the this is the data type, right? And here's several examples. Here's a data type. Muckstack is the constructor, and constructors can have arguments. So a data type has one or more constructors, but not necessarily just one. It can have more. And each constructor has zero or more arguments. So Booleans here is a data type that has two constructors, each of which have no arguments. So this vertical bar is what separates the constructors. So Boolean is a data type with two constructors, true and false, which you can pattern match on, just like you can pattern match any constructor. And color here, so there's another enumeration type, red, green, or blue. Again, three constructors, no arguments. This maybe type is very useful. So a maybe A has two constructors called nothing and just. Nothing has no arguments, and just has one. And list, which we come across before, you can't actually declare this in Haskell. It's built in because it uses this built-in syntax of open square brackets, close square brackets, and infix cons, or square brackets around the type. So you can't define this in Haskell. But here is how it would be defined if you could. It's a data type with two constructors, nil and infix cons. And the nil has no arguments, and infix cons has two arguments. Okay? So that's the way data types go. And you see data types ubiquitously all over Haskell programs. So what you tend to do when you start writing a program is to start writing new data types. Now, constructors are used. Somebody asked me about this in the break. Constructors are used both on the right-hand side to construct values and on the left-hand side to take them apart. So here is a function from color to Booleans. And the stuff over here, the Boolean constructor is used to build values. And on the left, I'm using the color constructors to take the values apart. And of course, when I've been matching over lists and muck stacks, I've been using pattern matching on the left to take them apart. So constructors are very special functions. They can be used in both directions. Ordinary functions like reverse or append can only be used on the right to put values together. They can't be used on the left to decompose values. Does that make sense? No.
Let's
Decomposition. So here is, have I got another decomposition example? Yes, here is a decomposition example. So here I'm using muckstack in this pattern matching context to say if focus is applied to muckstack of, I'm also using a new kind of pattern, a wild card that just says match anything and don't call it anything. So muckstack of anything in the empty list, then that's nothing. But so muckstack here, this constructor, I'm just using it as a way to say focus should be applied to an argument which must have been built with muckstack, right? Otherwise it wouldn't have type stack. So the only things that build stacks are muckstack constructors. So it must have been built with the muckstack, and it simply says take it apart, binding the first to nothing at all and checking that the second is empty. And here this pattern matching is saying the second component could be matched against the cons, and the head of the cons will call W. So it's just, it's like a sort of template. Imagine it's like a sort of skeleton on the left that's laid up against the value that is the argument of the function. If it fits, you just bind the variables. Does that help? Absolutely, yes. So it's only say variable, that's right. That names the this little head of the list that is the second component of the MOOC stack, and you can use that on the right. So it's extremely useful notation for decomposing values, and it's exactly dual. You know, you build with constructors on the right, and you take apart with constructors on the left. Yes?
The underscore there, you're using it as a wildcard, you're
saying? Yes. Oh,
no.
Yeah.
That was the invariant that if the right-hand side is empty, the left-hand side must be also.
Right. So here, so this particular function is trying to find what is the focus window. Well, my invariant was that, if the second list is empty, then the first must have been empty, so the focus window can't be here. The focus window is the head of the second list, right? And this is another good place to just remark about this null pointer thing. Right, so here, what is this function focus? It says, given a stack, which is the focus window? So you might think, if the stack is non-empty, I'll return the focus window, and if the stack is empty, I'll return the null pointer. Right? That would be a reasonable thing to return. Or perhaps I'll throw an exception. Right? So in Haskell, you would do neither of these things. You return a maybe type. So where's my maybe type? Here it is. Maybe A is nothing or just A. You can think of almost maybe A as like a sort of nullable. Maybe T is like nullable T, right? It's where nothing plays the role of null and just plays the role of, yes, it was there. So here, if the stack is empty, we return nothing. I mean, it's a bit cute, really, isn't it? We return nothing at all. But if there was a focus window, then we return just the window. And then the caller, you see, if the caller of focus can't get at the window that we return just by calling focus, because he's getting back a maybe window. So the types force him to pattern match on focus and say, well, if it returns nothing, well, then there wasn't a focus window, so you can say what you want to return then. And if it was just, so again, we're using pattern matching to decompose the result of the call to focus. Now we get to name the window in the just case. So this would be a good moment to pause, but I'd really like you to understand this pattern matching business and declaring data types. Yeah. Oh, would the compiler check here? So if you left out the nothing case and had just the just case, then that's non-exhaustive pattern. So what that would mean is the compiler would warn you and say there's a missing case here. Of course, you might know that focus will always return just for the particular stack that you give to foo. You know, maybe you have some ulterior reason to know that that stack couldn't be empty, but the compiler will warn you anyway. Oh, that's right. Yes, you can get that kind of null pointer. Yes, a pattern not matched. Yes, typically you want to make sure that you match all of your patterns, or very sure. Yeah, that's right. That is the equivalent of a null pointer exception. Yeah. But you get told about it in a way that you can't forget, right? Whereas it's all too easy just to forget that a null pointer is a possibility. Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah. Oh, right. You mean here, there's an initial capital on all these constructors. Is that what you mean? Yes. So this is purely a lexical convention, but it's one that Haskell enforces. And it's because constructors have this very special role. So I'm saying they can be used in patterns. Constructors can be used in patterns. So it's very important to know when something is a constructor and when it's an ordinary function. Ordinary functions like reverse can't be used in patterns. Right? So yes, you're forced to capitalize them. And yes, it's just a linguistic convention, but it's an enforced one. Yeah.
So is nothing defined somewhere else in the prelude?
Oh no. This is the whole definition of nothing. Nothing is fully defined. So when you declare a data type, you're declaring the type and you are declaring the constructors all simultaneously. Thanks. Yes. So this particular data type is declared in the prelude as it happens, but each one of these data type declarations declares a type and constructors all at once. Yes.
The cons operator is not a normal operator, so actually constructors.
That's right. This cons is a constructor. And in fact, Haskell lets you use, in a data type declaration, you can have infix constructors as well. But they must all begin with colon. It's the same. It's rather like saying the alphanumeric ones must start with a capital letter. The operator infix constructors all start with colon. So if you see something, an operator starting with a colon, you know it's a constructor. If it's an operator that doesn't start with colon, it's not a constructor. That's the rule. It's a bit... Oh, the colon load command is not part of Haskell at all. It's a sort of meta notation to talk to the Haskell interpreter that says, please load up this file. You couldn't write that in the middle of a Haskell program.
Okay. I'm sorry. You said that when there's a colon, the capital is like short for...
No, what I meant was that in a data type declaration, you could write a data type declaration that said, data type T is int colon... bang, colon, or something, bool, or, and there are some other constructors. Now, this colon, bang, colon thing is an infix constructor, right? So it plays just the same role as red, green, blue, nothing, and just, and so forth, but it can be written infix.
It's a colon.
Right. And by starting with a colon, you're saying, I'm a constructor, just as by starting with a capital letter, you're saying, I'm a constructor. There you go. If you can't, there's no uppercase plus. Yeah, that's the thing. Quick thing about modules and abstraction. I wanted to take the opportunity to say here, by using a new data type here, I give myself the opportunity to export stack without exporting muck stack. So if I export the type stack without exporting the constructor stack, I deny to my clients the possibility that they could call muckstack and thereby build a stack that didn't satisfy the invariance. And I also deny them the opportunity to pattern match on muckstack and thereby take apart a stack and see my implementation. So the deal is by exporting stack here, I'm exporting stack, but I'm not exporting muckstack in my export list, and thereby I get abstraction just by namespace control. It's a sort of cheap and cheerful kind of abstraction, but it works really well in practice. So this pattern match here would be rejected by the compiler, saying muckstack is not in scope. Right? It simply is not, it's not exported from here and it's not imported here. Does that make sense? That's a very, very simple way to build abstract data types, by hiding the representation. So you should think of the constructors as the representation for a data type, and then the functions that you export are the kind of manipulators that give you safe manipulation. So this is what you get with classes, in effect, that the methods of the class. Yeah.
If you're in this exported state and you look at, let's say, focus next, could you see make stack? Do you see that word?
You mean up here? If you call focus next, or could you see this code?
In its definition.
No, so this client, this module operations, doesn't ever get to look at the definition of focus next. It can call it knows its type, and it can call it, but it doesn't get to see its definition. Now, if you're sitting in GHCI, the interpreter, and you ask to move into the stack module and look at focus next, you can do that, or get Emacs out and look at it, but that's a different story, right? But you can't write code in here that is sensitive to the representation of stacks. That's the important thing. So that you know that you can change the representation of stacks without affecting any of the client program. That's what abstraction is all about. Okay. So just the picture of module imports. This is very similar to language like Python, incidentally, is that modules may import other modules and are explicit about what they export, and they form a kind of graph, a directed graph. In fact, they can be cyclic, so you can have mutually recursive modules. In at least GHC, lets you group modules into packages, again rather similar to Python's packages. A package for us is a unit of distribution. It is a group of modules which you intend to seal up and ship to somebody else, and it's the unit in which apt-get might move stuff around, indeed does. I think that's all we need to say about modules, really, except just to remark that it's a very, very cheap mechanism. It's really just a namespace control mechanism to say what is in scope where, no more than that. But very powerful for that all the same. Simple things are good. Okay? All right. Well, now, So I want to do two big things in the next, how long have we got? It's 3:30. We're going until
five?
We have an hour, so that means we have an hour and a half. Right? Is that right? Yes, we have an hour and a half altogether. And I want to be sure to do two things. One is to tell you a bit about type classes. Another is to tell you a bit about I.O. Those are two chunks that we haven't talked about at all. Now, type classes are Haskell's most distinctive feature. They're to do with the type system, and I'm going to try to give you some sort of visceral feel for what they're about without hopefully blowing too many fuses. So here's the idea. So think about delete. So when I sit in Xmonad and I go in a meta key C, that deletes a window. I could demonstrate it to you, but I'm sure you'll believe me that if I utter a suitable incantation, the window will disappear. Now, what happens to the stack? Well, X is going to say, here is a window, and the user has just deleted it. Now, somehow we have to find that window in the stack, which means we need to run down the stack saying, is it this one? Is it this one? Is it this one? So we need to be able to compare windows, at least for equality. Right? But when I said, this works for any window type at all, I really did mean any window type at all, even one that doesn't support equality. So in order to make delete work, I can't really give it this type. I've been saying previously that when I've said for all types W, and in fact in Haskell you can, well in GHC at least, you can write F-O-R-A-L-L space W dot, which is, but writing an upside down A looks more impressive and takes up less real estate. But that's really what we mean. But the thing is that it really only works for W's that support equality. And a similar thing happens for sorting. If you want to sort a list, suppose you want to sort windows in some order or other, then we could only do that if the windows were ordered in some way. So you could say, well, everything is ordered. And this is what Java and C++ and many other languages do. They say every type supports equality and comparison and perhaps hashing and maybe serialization and, oh, well, this and that. So a bunch of things are kind of built in that can be done to any type. So in Haskell, that is not the case. If you say a function has type for all W, something like this, you mean for all W's, including ones that have no ordering and no hashing and no serialization. So sort cannot have this type. Right? You really cannot sort something into canonical order if it has type for all A. So what we do is, beg your pardon, I just want to remark, this of course applies to lots of other situations. Serialization is one, but numbers is, if anything, even more important. So square, so what type does square have? X times X. Well, does it go int to int, or float to float, or rational to rational, complex to complex, matrix to matrix? Who knows? There are lots of numeric-like types, and we'd like to be able to say, do multiplication for anything that is numeric-like. So here's the way we say this in Haskell. So this is this funny double arrow notation. And the way to pronounce it is, for all types W that support the eq operations, stack of W to W to stack of W. And similarly, sort says, for all types A, I've left out the for all now, which Haskell does typically, for all types A that support the ord operations, that is greater than and greater than or equal to, take a list of A to a list of A. Serialize, for all types A that support the show operation that converts things to strings, converted to string. Square, for all of the types that supports the num operations. So you get the idea, sort of intuitively? And that's in contrast to functions like reverse, which really can work completely independent of the type. You don't need equality order to do reverse. You don't need anything. If you want to filter out all the elements of a list that satisfy, you know, for which a particular function returns true, you don't need to know anything except that the argument type of the function is the same as the element type of the list. Okay? Yeah. They're a little like Java interfaces,
yeah. Are they defined in the language, or are they defined somewhere?
They're defined right here. So they're defined in the language, yeah. So I'm going to take numbers as an example, because because numbers is an example that's not built into to Java or C# in the way that equality and ordering and hashing are. And so I find it a sort of more compelling one. So here we go. So square has the type for all types n that satisfy the num operations. It goes n to n. And here's the way we define num operations. So look at this bit in the top right-hand corner. Try to temporally expunge from your mind. You're allowed to put it back afterwards. But just temporally, try to forget everything you know about classes in object-oriented languages, because It's the same kind of thing, but it's sufficiently different that if you try to map them on too early, it just makes you confused. So for the moment, just put it to one side and try to forget that you know anything about classes, or think of just translate this to Fugle, and you'll be happy, right? So the class declaration in Haskell lists with their types what I mean by the operations of the num operations is what I call it. It just lists what they are and gives their type. So another way to say it, A is a num-like type if it has a plus and a minus and a multiplication and a negate with these types. Okay? So that is very interface-like. It does give you the interface for a type. All right? Then the second thing you can do is you can take a class and a type here, num and int, and you can say, well, int is an example of a nummable type. It's a num-like type. And when you make that claim, you justify the claim by providing a witness. You say, well, to add to int, you use plus int. I'm assuming here that plus int is some primitive operation defined somewhere else. We type int to int, and similarly mul int, and so forth, right? So to add two things, you'd use plus int. To multiply them, you use mul int. To negate them, you use neg int, and so forth. Okay, so the instance declarations explain for any particular type how it is that it has the num operations. Okay? Yeah?
In a type class, can you create invariants of it in the type signature?
Oh, you mean can you say that zero times x equals x, zero? No, you can't. It would be very nice if you could. You could supply extra laws, rather like that QuickCheck thing. In fact, you might write down some QuickCheck properties that were true, but then you'd have to test them. So Haskell doesn't have built into it the notion of proof. But if you wanted to write a verification tool, which, as it happens, is something I'm busily trying to do at the moment, then it's a good base to stand on in this purely functional world. But no, you can't. There's no way to say it in the language as it stands. Okay? So far, so good. You've just got the idea of what a class declaration is and an instance declaration. And then, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a rather implementation-oriented idea of what happens. Because I find this helpful. I hope that you find it helpful. But somehow, when I'm understanding a linguistic concept, I often find it helpful to have some notion of how the jolly compiler deals with it. I know that, you know, then you can maybe throw the scaffolding away and just think high and pure thoughts. But here's what happens. So when you write this definition, squares type num n, n to n, the compiler translates it into this. So it adds an extra, for the num constraint, you can think of this as a kind of constraint on the type, it's like a bounded type. It adds an extra value argument, which I've called d here, short for dictionary. And so you can think of this as the method suite of functions on numbers, right? So square takes as its first argument a little record of functions, the addition function, the multiplication function, the negation function, and so forth, a little record of functions that operates on values of type n. And you can see that once it's got that record of functions, square is laughing, right? Because all he's got to do is to select from the dictionary the multiplication function. So now this star is not actually a multiplier at all. It simply takes its first argument, d, and reaches into it and fetches out the third component. Does that make sense? So the method suite is passed as a separate argument. So the class declaration, when you write a class declaration, what the compiler does is it generates a new data type, right, which is like a little record of values. The little instead of having two arguments like muckstack did, this one has as many arguments as there are things in the num interface, the num class. Right? And so here's the data type. Oh, you notice that all these values here, all these arguments are functional values. They're very often functional values. It's a functional language after all. And star, as I was saying, becomes a selector. Star takes a num dictionary and two value arguments and multiplies them together. And how does it do it? It takes a num dictionary and m happens to be the one, it's the second one down, isn't it? Yes, it's the second one down. Right, so it just picks the second component. Does that make sense? That give you a sort of visceral feel for what a class declaration generates and how square might be compiled.
Yeah? Was that supposed to be an equal sign on the num a in the bottom right? Right
where?
I mean an equals pointer as opposed to a
here.
Minus sign.
Oh, yeah, this guy. Ah, Right, so this blue stuff is translated, right? So here in this world, it's written double equals because you think of it as being like a constraint on the types. But in this translated form, this is what actually gets to run. It really is a value argument. There really is an honest to goodness record of values that's passed. So I've just turned it into an ordinary arrow, and here is the record of values really does have an honest to goodness data type value. So the class over in the source world becomes a data type in the target world, and values of that data type are passed as auxiliary arguments invisibly to causal square. Did that make sense?
That helps.
Yeah.
Just to make sure I understand, if you're defining plus, then you have m __.
Yes, that's right. So there'd be a record definition for plus here. Plus would select the first component. So along with when a class declaration gets translated to a data type declaration, and one of these selectors for each of the operations of the class. So the things that look like arithmetic are nothing more than selectors. So now you might wonder, where does this argument come from? How does Square get to have this argument? Does the programmer have to write extra stuff to pass it? Well, no, of course not. What happens? Well, the first thing is we need to build some dictionaries somewhere. Here we just got past the dictionary. Where did it come from? Well, dictionaries start life at instance declarations. When you write an instance declaration, the compiler will generate for you a value of type numInt, which I've here called dNumInt. The programmer doesn't see any of this, of course, and it's populated with the operations that you supplied over here. And then when you make a call, if you made a call to Square on a value of type int, then dNumInt would be invisibly passed as an argument. And here is another example where I apply sum square, right? So let's say sum square x y is the sum of the square of x and the square of y. So what do we do? Well, the compiler translates this into a function that takes an extra argument, here this num argument that I've called d, and it passes that d to the plus, so it's got this plus selects out of the d, the addition operation, but it also passes it on to the clause of Square. So you didn't have to write in your source program, you didn't write any d's. You don't write any of these d's anywhere. The compiler inserts them. Does that make sense? So it's as if the method suites just travel around independently, generated by the compiler, generates these extra record values which get passed around and used in the appropriate places. And all you need to think is, for every numeric type, n to n to n. Is that the silence of incomprehension or the silence of satisfaction and awed admiration?
is that why the syntax is written that way, to sort of suggest to your mind that, you know, this definition of how I do my operations is really kind of like an argument that goes along?
Yes, so that is why it appears as a sort of arrow-like thing here. But actually in mathematics and the sort of the theory of programming now, which is people often write types like for all a such that a is satisfies num or something like that, meaning for all a such that a satisfies num, blah blah blah, and so it has the same kind of flavour. So it has quite a nice reading n satisfies num as well, but. But it has a very direct implementation, which is very nice too. Okay, so this is one way in which you can build big overloaded functions by gluing smaller ones together, right? But another way in which you can build them is by building big instances by gluing smaller instances together. Here is if I got the equality class, so that's more familiar one. Then I want to take equality of how do I take equality of lists of things? Think about that. How would I say that a list of A's is an equality type, that is, has equality operations? Well, I can only take equality on a list of things if I can take equality on the elements of the list, right? So that's what this part here is. This instance declaration says, if I have equality on A's, then I can give you equality on list of A's. And how do I prove that? I give a witness, as it were, I show that the equality on lists How does equality on lists work? Well, two empty lists, O equal, and a list whose head is X and whose tail, whose X cons X is and Y cons Y's. If they're both conses, what have we got to do? We've got to check for equality on the heads, X and Y, and on the tails, X's and Y's. Now, on the heads, that's what needs equality on the elements, right? That's what makes use of this constraint up here in the instance declaration. And on the tails, well, that's just a recursive call to the equality that we are now defining. So again, that's what you write in your source program. And here I've given you the translation into the lower level language in which the instance declaration gets turned into a function now that takes a method suite for equality on A's and returns a method suite for equality on list of A's. And here's the code for it.
Is this some kind of mental shorthand you use for like the equal arrow?
Which one?
Instance.
This guy?
Yeah, that guy. So you're mean, saying that before when what you were using for the arrow, was x2, you were using the word 2 as
yes.
The equivalent of that arrow. Is there some similar thing that you do?
So I'm thinking, I sometimes think of it as imply. Oh dear, as implies, right? So it says equality on A implies equality on list of A's. That's a good way to think of it.
Okay.
You can also think of it more constructively as a witness for equality on A's. That is, by witness for, I mean a record of equality functions. Well, of course, there's only one equality function, but there might be inequality. A witness for, if I give you a proof, a constructive proof, that is, an actual bunch of functions that take equality on A's,
okay.
Then I can give you back a bunch of functions that give me equality on a list of A's. I say a bunch because, well, the num case is clearer, right? But
it could be a bunch.
Yeah, it could be a bunch. And so then you can think of it as a function. Right? And that, in fact, is exactly that idea of in some ways you can think of it as implication, a sort of logical implication, and put on a different pair of spectacles and you can think of it as constructive building of evidence for something from evidence from something else. That's called the Coe-Howard isomorphism. It's a sort of direct correspondence between logical thinking, A implies B, and programming constructive thinking. From A, I can construct B. So if you want to make friends at cocktail parties, just mutter Coe-Howard isomorphism at your very attractive partner and see how quickly you get dumped. Yes?
How much read the last line? Is that like an otherwise clause?
Oh, yes, yes. So this is, do you remember when we very first had swap, I said, the catch-all case, I said swap of W's equals, and this says wildcard, wildcard, so this matches anything. So it's exactly like an otherwise. Yes, thank you. Top to bottom, that's right. Top to bottom pattern matching, that's the rule, yes. Okay. So, one more quick example, complex numbers. So if I want to, oh, big button, yeah?
If you rewrote that and moved that up two lines, then you would catch that one first and it would always be false.
That's right, it would always be false, yeah. And the compiler would say the following two lines can never be reached if it was having a good day. Which it probably would for that, not always entirely obvious. So I'll skip rapidly. I did want to make one point about this, because it shows something that I haven't mentioned yet at all. So here's an example for complex numbers. If I want to declare the type of complex number, so a complex number is just a complex of, do I want complex of floats or complex of doubles? I don't know. I'll just do complex of A's for the moment. So a complex of A is just a pair of A's for the real and imaginary part. And then if A is a num type, then complex of A is a num type, and here's how I do addition. I add the real parts and the imaginary parts separately. But the point I wanted to make from this slide was this new function from integer. So I've mentioned plus and minus and times and negate. From integer has the type integer to A. So this is a little weird because there is no argument with type A. In object-oriented programming, you always have an argument that is that carries the method suite, right? You dispatch on an argument that, in fact, is always the first argument that you dispatch on, except in multi-methods. But here, this is like dispatching on the result type, because here, this is what we want to do. Increment ought to have the type num a arrow a, and you'd like to write increment x is x plus 1. Oh, but what's this 1? Ah, is it an integer, a float, a double, a rational, a matrix, a complex number? Who knows? And it would screw up our arithmetic story about, oh, isn't it nice to be able to use square on any kind of number if we couldn't use ink on every kind of number. It would, you know, kind of, you'd be dead in the water, really. It would look good, and then you're whole beneath the waterline, but you can't use literal constants, which, after all, do play an important role in mathematics. So, in Haskell, what one means is, it means from integer applied to one. It's like a syntactic sugar. Remember, you know, these square brackets are having syntactic sugar? So whenever you write one, the compiler sees from integer applied to one. In fact, from integer applied to a literal one of type integer. So this means x plus from integer of one. So from integer of one has any numeric type. Right, so this kind of just works. And here's how the from integer might work for complex. So this is quite remarkable. This really makes a huge difference in all sorts of ways. It makes a sort of qualitative jump in what you can do by having methods in this interface that are overloaded in effect not on the argument type but the result type. Yeah.
How does it know which from integer implementation?
How does the compiler know which implementation to use? Well, you can see that it's passed as its argument a method suite for num. And it just passes the from integer component of that. It just uses the from integer component of this dictionary argument, right, remember? That is the beauty of the method suites moving around independently of the values. Right?
So there can only be one method suite passed in.
Ah, what happens if you had num A and num B both passed into a single function, and then you said one? Right? Which one did you mean? Well, it would depend. Then the compiler is doing type inference. It's trying to figure out how things are connected up. And you can write programs which are ambiguous so that it really isn't clear, and then it rejects your program, and you have to add a bit more type information. But most of the time, it's clear from the context that you can only mean one. I could give you an example later. Yeah?
So theoretically, then, instead of a num, if it has been like a string of some type,
Whoa, hang on, no, I didn't understand that.
So you have your definition in the...
In here?
No, the bottom two line, yeah.
Okay.
So instead of a num, because you're saying that the from integer is getting called on the num.
The from integer, so this little phrase here, that one, it's exactly as if you typed from integer of one of type integer.
Right, and that from integer is coming from num.
That's this from integer, yeah.
Okay, so...
Oh, no, there's only one from integer. It's like saying there's only one reverse in scope. I mean, of course, you can use modules and scoping to have different from integers. But here, there's just one from integer, just as there's only one plus. There's a plus, and it has type num A, arrow, A to A to A. That's the type of plus. And of course, you can, by giving instance declarations, you can have plus on floats and plus on rationals, and you can have from integer on floats and from integer on rationals. You could say instance num string and have arithmetic over strings. That would be fine. And then when you wrote one, you would have whatever you define from integer of one to be for strings. Yeah. Okay. I think I'm gonna skip this because I'm trying to close the circle here. When we looked at QuickCheck, we thought, oh, it's rather amazing that it's able to invent test data without really being told very much about what the arguments are. But in fact, the way it does so is by using the same type class mechanism. I think this is probably going to end up being homework for you. I'll just do it real quick, as they say. So the story here is, QuickCheck has type. Oh, drat! That should be testable A, arrow, A to IO unit. I'm going to get to this IO stuff in a second, so don't worry about that part. Just think about this testable. What does it mean to be testable? A value A is testable if we can provide a test function with type A to random number supply to bool. Right? That is, it takes a value of this testable type and a random number supply so that it can generate random numbers and give you a Boolean result. Now, so Booleans are trivially testable. You don't need a random number. You just return the Boolean. The really interesting thing comes for functions. Right? So look at this. If you wish to spend just an hour in the bath contemplating only four lines of Haskell, this would be a good four lines to contemplate. But this says, a function from A to B is testable if what? Well, if B is testable, that is, if the result of the function is testable, and I can invent arbitrary values of type A. What does it mean to invent arbitrary values of type A? Well, here's the arbitrary class. It means that given a random number supply, I can generate an A, right? So in other words, being in the arbitrary class means that I can take a random number supply and just use one of the random numbers from the supply, let's say the first one, and generate a value of that type from it. So then how do we test a function, assuming these things? Well, we can test the function given a... So test takes a value and a random number supply and is supposed to produce a Boolean. So what do? So here's the function, here's the random number supply. We take the function, we apply it to an arbitrary value of the appropriate type, right? So that's RB, that's this guy, applied to the random number supply. Well, we don't want to apply it to R. We really want to take R and split it into two pieces because we need two random number supplies so that we don't just use the same random number all the time, right? So if we have a split that takes a random number supply and splits it into two, then we can, so here's, we call split and we pattern match on the result to get R1 and R2. So we give R1 to RB. That makes a new value of the argument type of the function. Now we apply F to that, and what do we get? We get a value of type B. And what can we do with value of type Bs? Good answer, we can test them, right? Isn't that cool? We just apply test at this at the type B, passing it the depleted random number supply. I was so excited when I first saw this definition in John Hughes's paper. Yeah.
So does QuickCheck have rules for doing, like, obviously for your, in your domain you're going to put like more constraints on genetic, I mean, but can it do stuff like just based on like arithmetic types, like maybe your type is like, you know, a list or a bool or something like that, and it create that for that?
Oh, if it's a list or a bool, it's probably a data type. It says data type T is T1 of list or T2 of bool.
Right.
And then indeed, yes, it can do this kind of game by making, you have to make T an instance of arbitrary. So that's your obligation. When you make a new data type, you make it an instance of arbitrary. Once you've done that, QuickCheck will do the rest.
So, it would be
cool to have it make it automatically get instances of arbitrary, and there's work on that in generic programming, but it's not part of the language. But it's really pretty easy to do. It's pretty well specified what you need to do to make it an instance of arbitrary. And then you get all this checking apparatus for free. Yeah?
This seems to be a place where you've really departed from like how you can think of type classes as interfaces and object-oriented programming. This instance here seems to be something that would be very hard to do.
I think it would, right. Because, yes, you're for a start, you're looking at, you're kind of taking apart the type of a function type. Right? So function types are already a bit awkward to deal with as types, as anonymous types in Java. So I think it'd be quite hard to reproduce this directly. Nevertheless, now let's see. John Hughes is doing the quick check in Erlang, and somebody else is doing quick check in Java or C#, I believe. Don't know. I think the idea is being ported in various forms because it's so neat. But it doesn't come out quite as smoothly. It takes more than four lines. Okay, so I apologize for having taken you from introducing you to type classes right the way up to quick check in like 20 minutes, because it's I think it's nice to close the circle, and also I find this a really compelling example for why type classes are good. Remember, quick check is just a library; it's not a new language stuff. Here's an example, and I'm going to skip this too. There's nothing linguistically built in apart from type classes itself. And there's good papers to read about QuickCheck, incidentally, that tell you things about how to generate data that inhabits densely the invariants that you want. There's a danger otherwise you generate lots of test data that's irrelevant because it doesn't satisfy the initial invariants. Lots of stuff in QuickCheck, but that's not really part of this talk. So, quick remark about the connection with object-oriented programming, which we've been discussing a little bit as we go along. So you can now put your OO implant back in, right? And we've remarked already that with object-oriented programming, the method suite travels with the values, right? Whereas in type classes, the method suite travels independently of the values, and the compiler kind of orchestrates matters so that the two meet up at just the right time. And really, the big benefit you get from the result stuff is, well, it's, I guess there's two things. One is it's most strongly shown up with these things that are overloaded just on the result type. But also sometimes you'll find the argument type is buried. Like if you have a tree of A, well, you might have num A, tree of A, arrow something, then finding any particular A value in a tree can be a bit awkward. Right? You haven't got a naked A value right at the top. It's a bit awkward. So it works really... It has a very different flavour in the end. And another big difference is that in object-oriented languages, you get a lot of subtyping going on. And here, really all that's happening, is the right way to think of it is it's more like polymorphism, parametric polymorphism. But again, I'm not going to say any more about that. Just to mark, this whole type class thing was kind of an accident. We were just thinking initially about how do we do equality and ordering and serialization in a neat way. And Phil Wadler and his student Steve Block produced this sort of email message initially for how to do type classes. And we thought, that would be so cool to do it sort of neatly. And then it was like one of those things you let into your house because, you know, it'll sort of do the housework sort of. And then it sort of takes over your life. The type class stuff has turned out to be extremely useful for all manner of things that we had never thought of at all to begin with. This is a graph of our initial experiences, right? So we started off sort of going to wild enthusiasm. Then this is when I started to implement it. I began to think it was really a bad idea because it was so tricky to implement well, and it was only used for numbers and serialization. You know, why didn't we just build those in? So after a bit of hacking and also the feedback from users who started to think up new uses for type classes, eventually got to the point where we think, well, of course, every schoolgirl needs these things. Yeah, you want to change your tape, this? Yes. Is it like multi-methods? Well, so multi-methods still are really matching on the arguments, aren't they? But they're matching on more than one argument, right? Matching on the result is very strange, because you don't have the result yet until you call the function. You can't call the function until you know it. So it's much more like type-based dispatch. It's like a type-passing mechanism in which the types are being passed around and you scrutinize the types. It's more like reflection. And in fact, you can get something that's very close to reflection with a class that's called typeof. So there's another thing you can type. Did I put reflection here? I should have put reflection in here as well, because you can make a type class that pretty much gives you a reflective interface too. Okay. We good? In a way, my feeling is I hope to just give you a flavor of what type classes might be rather than a sort of a deep, visceral understanding. But I think what I most hope you go away with is think, maybe there's something interesting going on there. It's kind of like classes in object-oriented languages, but really quite unlike in other ways. And I still don't kind of exactly feel as if I know how the world fits together here. All right. I.O. I promised you I.O., and I'm going to get there. So because in the end, we've got to do it. Otherwise, the machine gets hot. And here's the tension that we were discussing earlier. Right, we need a side effect somewhere. And particularly for Window Manager, we're going to need some side effects. So how are we going to do this I.O. stuff? The I.O. in the Window Manager bit occurs, of course, here when we FFI out to the rest of the world. So the first thing you think of when you think about doing I.O. in a functional setting is to say, well, let's just have a function that does I.O. Oh, let's just have a function in inverted commas, because it's no longer a function, right? Because in addition to delivering its value, it also does something else along the side, so it's not really purely a function. So let's have putstra. We type string to, well, what? Well, unit, perhaps, right? We're not really interested in the result, like void. But now the trouble is then that a function like this, our swap function, could now, if we had functions like this, well, inside swap, we could call putstra, and the type of swap would be unchanged, right? Putstra could, you know, swap could call putstra, and so some side effects would have happened behind the scene. So all my claims about the types showing you what's going on would be as null and void, right? And it gets worse, because if I have a list, so here's a list, putstra yes and putstra no. Now, in a call-by-value language, this would mean call putstra of yes and then call putstra of no, take those two unit values and form them into a list. But Haskell is a lazy language, a point that I've not emphasized very much so far. So what this does is it forms a sort of suspension for putstra yes and a suspension for putstra no, and it doesn't evaluate those until you evaluate the list. And so it's the customer of the list, the person to whom the list is passed. He may just ignore the first element and evaluate the second one. Or he may evaluate the first one and then ignore the second one. Or he may ignore the whole thing. Or he may evaluate the mover. Do you see what I mean? You just wouldn't have a clue which order the strings would come out in. So laziness is really the killer, right? Laziness tells you this approach is just not going to work. And so for a long time, this was very embarrassing to us because we had a wonderful story, sort of mathematically sound and everything else story, but we really couldn't do any I.O. Our programs had typed string to string. But because laziness meant that we could not sin, right? Because this kind of sinning here wasn't really open to us, so we sort of stayed impure but embarrassed for many years. Yes? No, I actually mean that in C, if you call a procedure, you could print things, you can read things from a file, you could store things in static data, you can read things from static data.
Yeah, but if I'm not affecting Haskell, then what do I care?
Oh, at the moment I'm still in the Haskell world, right? So I'm imagining this being a Haskell function, right? But if I had a Haskell function that called a C function that did these sinful things, I would be in the same difficult state of not knowing whether it would print yes, no, or no, yes, or just yes, or just no, or neither. That would be bad, right? You really like to know. I.O. is something we kind of a bit old-fashioned caring about what actually happens I.O.-wise. Yes?
So why is the order of things being printed, why is having an order bad, like in math, you go from left to right?
Right. So call-by-value languages solve this problem by just saying, let's go left to right, and let's evaluate everything. That's ML, that's Lisp, that's every other functional language apart from Haskell. Is a call-by-value functional language and works left to right and does indeed have putStraw with this type. But Haskell, in effect, has taken this rather idiosyncratic choice of saying we're going to be lazy, and so we don't know. It's not just we don't know whether it's left to right or right to left. We also don't know whether this is going to get evaluated at all. Maybe the first is, but not the second, or the second is, but not the first. Do you see what I mean? So the order of evaluation is not part of the language design. It's up to the client of the list. The person who consumes the list decides the order in which it's evaluated, right? Which is part of what that's what the programmer decides, in effect. So this side effect is not on.
I just used putStraw, right? putStraw and hello world, but on my laptop, right? And I got hello world. But then I tried putting in the list.
Yeah.
And I get a bunch of little errors. So
I'll tell you why.
Okay.
So and it's because when you build this list, you can write this in Haskell, but putStraw does not have this type, so you're not quite getting what you expect. putStraw instead has this type. Right. So at this point, this is also a point at which you may like to contemplate in your bars, because I think this is one of the things that Haskell gives to the world. Right. So in the end, in 20 years' time, people may not be programming with Haskell, but I think they will be programming with languages that are explicit about effects. And they may be explicit about effects in a similar way to this, maybe not exactly the same. So here's the idea. A value, remember this is value-oriented programming, a value of type IOT is a kind of action. You might think of an action, it's sometimes called computation or script, perhaps, which, when performed or executed, may do some I.O. and return a value of type T. So putStraw is a string that gives me a value. So a value of type I.O., I.O.T., is a first-class value. I can pass it around. I can put it in a list, return it as a result from a function, pass it as an argument to the function. It's a completely first-class value. But when I perform it, I need to tell you how I perform it. But when I perform it, then its latent effects, as it were, will take effect. That's why I say it's like a shell script. A shell script is just a piece of text, right? You can process it with other shell scripts. You can store it in files. You can email it to your neighbor. And only when you say, run it, will its, as it were, latent side effects become actualized. Does that make sense? Right? So think of IoT as a sort of latent effect. So evaluating an action is a bit like looking at a shell script. That doesn't do anything. It's only running it or performing it, as I shall say, that has an effect. So how to think of I.O.? So one way to think of I.O., this is me still in my implementation mode, trying to give you a sort of visceral feel for how it could be implemented, is not implemented quite like this. This isn't quite an accurate picture, but it's close. You can think of an IOA as a function from world to a pair of IA and a new world. So this is a sort of rather egocentric functional programmer's view of the world, in which your function is the center of the world, and the entire universe sort of goes in one side of your function, gets modified a bit by your function, and emerges in a purely functional way. You know, a freshly minted universe comes out of the other, rather the same way that our stack functions took a stack as an input and produced a new stack as output, rather than by modifying it in place. So an IOA is a function that takes a world and gives an A in a new world. And I should draw it with a little box like this. So it takes in a world, produces a new world, and a value, a pair, two results. Okay?
Is the result the IO or the world? I mean, what?
Think of IO as a type constructor like stack.
Okay.
So it's an IO of something.
Right.
Right. So it, just as we had stack of window, this is IO of A. So and here I'm saying you can read IO of A as function from world to pair of A and world.
But is if I'm you know if we're using that to understand you know put stra hello world is hello world the A?
So putstra, where are we? Putstra has an argument that's a string. So if you say
right.
putstra hello world,
right.
that's that string. So putstra applied to the string hello world produces as its result an action, which when performed produces a new world, that is a world in which hello world has appeared on your terminal, and the unit value.
So that's a metaphor.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. Actually, the universe does not disappear into your laptop when you run a Haskell program. But you should. You know, you can think of it like that. Yes. Yeah. Sorry. The unit value. Yes. Yes. In here, the unit value is the A in the putstra thing. Yes. We'll see shortly computations that return interesting values that are not just unit. There's a question over in the middle. Yeah. IO does indeed impose an execution order, and so it should, because if you print hello and then goodbye, you would like it to say hello and then goodbye, not goodbye and then hello.
Is that part of your IO type?
Yes, it is, and I shall. Here's how we do it. Excellent question. So here's I'm going to try to stick these two together. I've got getLine, which has type IO string. So here's something that has an IO action that has no input, but gets from standard in a string, right? So it takes the world. And it removes from your keyboard the first line you type and spits it out here and produces a depleted world in which your keyboard no longer has that in it, as it were. Your fingers have emitted it, that thing, right? So that's getLine. So it has type IO string. Putstra has the type that we showed before. And now what I'd like to do is to beg your pardon. So here's our hello world thing. Why did I show you that along with getLine? I want to compose these two. I now want to compose these two together to do a compound thing like this. I want to take getLine, I want to take its output, and I want to feed it into putstra so I can read a line and echo it back. So how do I do that? Because that's what imposes the order that you were describing, right? So here's how I do it. I use this do notation. So this now is new notation. It goes do, very quiet, open curly brace, then L, so this L is the string. So L has type string, left arrow, getLine. That's this guy, right, whose type was IO string. So getLine has type IO string, and L on the left has type just string. So you can think of the arrow as drawing the string out, right? So here's the L. And then we call then semicolon, just like C. So something that looks like C. So we've learned some lessons, right, which is that to get success in the world, you must look like C. So we tried hard to do that here. We even use curly braces. And then we call putstra of L. And that's it. So that's echo. So here's echo. It is a value of type IO unit, and this do notation glues together. Here's composition again, but a different kind of composition. We're composing two IO actions together, but plumbing the output of one into the input of the other. Does that make sense? I mean, this at this point, you should be thinking, this is what we would write in the languages we're all used to. And indeed it is.
I mean, it looks like a variable.
I don't have it. No, it's not a variable. It's not a location. Right? It's the name for the value that getLine returns. You can't in a subsequent line say L becomes something else. Or if you did, you'd be defining a completely new L that simply shadows the old one. But indeed, it's deliberately suggestive of things that we're somewhat familiar with, yes.
So, yeah. So do is basically we want to find a sequence.
Yes. That's right. Yes. So at least for the I/O monad. So do is actually allows you to do allows you to do computations other than just I/O-ish things. There's a lot more things you can do with do because you can generalize this idea of composing boxes like this, which have the scary name monad, and there are lots of monads that I shan't tell you. I'm only going to concentrate on the I/O monad, and so you can think of do as being associated with I/O, and for that it does sequencing. Yes. I just don't want you to run away to thinking that do always does sequencing, because sometimes it doesn't. But for I/O, it always does. So that we need one more thing before we can write interesting programs with this do notation, and that is, what happens if we want to say get two lines? So that's a computation with type I/O of a pair of strings. So we can call get line twice, naming the results S1 and S2. But then we need a way to say, and now return the pair. Well, so there's a combinator, or function, called return. We type A to IOA, and it's a box that looks like this. It says, do make no effect on the world. Just take your input, this A, and return it. So that's why I've drawn the line going straight through. Right, takes the argument and returns it as the result, having done no IO at all. So if something has a type IOT, that doesn't mean that it does necessarily do some IO. It just means that it might. And return doesn't do any. So we do a get line, which does some I/O, does some input, get line, does some input, return does no input or output, but nevertheless glues together S1 and S2 and returns them here as the result of this whole computation. There you are. That's really all you need to know about I/O in Haskell. Because with this stuff, you can now write arbitrary I/O performing computations, and the fact that they do I/O shows up in their types. Once you have an I/O typed value, you can't turn it back into a pure value. There is no function with type I/O int to int, right? Because that would take a side effect in computation and turn it into a pure one. Yeah.
This return combinator you have here.
Yeah.
Is it only function to get the value out of the two?
Yeah, it typically just shows up at the end of a do here.
Okay.
Yeah. It's kind of like a... It turns out it has a very... it's a kind of one of those things that turns out to just fit. If you look at the sort of, you know, the sort of mathematical background for this, all the mathematicians thought this out 20 years ago, and they had this. So we thought, oh, we'll do the same thing. And we called it return rather than unit, which is what they called it, because return is more sort of resonant here of what we do. But it's not a keyword. Right? This is not return at the keyword like it is in C. This is just a function that is, in fact, it's one of the operations of the monad class. But you could think of it as just being a function that's exported by the prelude, not a keyword. And that's its type. So this do notation that I've introduced as completely new notation, in fact, is just syntactic sugar for functions. Again, so here are the rules for desugaring do notation. So do of x left arrow e semicolon, then a whole bunch more do stuff, means e, and then this funny infix operator, whose type I give here. So infix operator called bind. So e bind, and then a lambda. So this is a function of x that binds x, because x is in scope in s, and then do of s. So again, I don't want to linger here very long, because... there's lots of background material like this, some written by me, but I just wanted you to absorb the idea that everything that I've shown you with the do notation is just syntactic sugar that can be decomposed into calls of this bind operator that takes a computation delivering an A and a function that, given the A value, not IO-fied, given the computation of type B, and wraps it up into a computation of type B. That's rather wonderful. Yeah. Oh, sure. Files, yes.
So that means that since you can't store anything persistently in memory, you could fake it by storing things persistently in files and then reading them back in?
Sure. So you can store things in files and read them back in. That's fine. Once you're in this I/O world, you can do anything you can do in C. And furthermore, you don't destroy any of the nice properties that the functions have, because they all announce that they are talking to the file system or to the stock exchange or to whatever it is by saying IOT. That's fine, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the foreign function interface works in the same way?
It does indeed. Where are we? Where's the foreign function interface? Drat. Yes, it does. I'll get to that. I'm going to, let's see, where are we? 420. I'm going to skip. I skip a bit. This is a bit about desugaring, which I'm going to skip. This is just a remark that in all these slides, I've typically used braces and semicolons, but they're entirely optional. You can instead use layout, as you can in, I think Python has layout, doesn't it? Yes. So you can use layout, and then you don't need to use braces and semicolons. In fact, you can use a mixture of the two. So, I tend to use braces and semicolons just to make quite sure that everybody understands exactly how it's laid out. Yeah?
Can you spend a minute talking about how sequencing is enforced by...
Oh, how's the sequencing enforced? Yes, yes. So sequencing is enforced by this purple arrow here, right? So Putstra can't do anything until it gets the world, right? And the world is produced by getline, so that forces getline. It's like a spreadsheet, right? So now, of course, so inside GHC, since we don't squeeze the world through it, but there really is a sort of token that stands for the world that is passed around literally by the program. And that's what makes getline happen before putstra. It really is a data dependency inside the compiler. Mm. But that's what models the sequencing. Yeah?
I'm always picturing these parallel processes evaluating expressions, and then one of them hits this. Is that really the world you're talking about as one particular part of the evaluating stream?
Well, so I think it's good to think about parallel processes evaluating expressions. But once you're in this I/O world, you're in something much more constrained and sequential. Right. The right thing, I think, to think about I/O so far, the right thing to do is to think sequential here. Right. You're back into the conventional world of, essentially, you're back into imperative programming. This is imperative programming embedded within Haskell.
But is I/O global across the whole Haskell application, or is there scope to an I/O?
Is there scope to an I/O? Once you're in I/O, you can't wrap I/O up in something that has a pure external type. Right, so once you've done some input output, you can't conceal that. Except if you do, there's a function called unsafe perform IO, which says I promise not to report any compiler bugs if I use this function. But you know, just call print here and don't tell anybody. But aside from that, no. So typically, an application will have an IO around the outside of the application with a large functional interior, and that's what you'll see Xmonad does if you look at it afterwards. The I/O is like a sort of rind on the outside of the application that interacts with the world, and then a big central functional chunk does everything, does all the hard work. Okay. Where are we? Now, so let's see, 420. So I'm going to spend just a few minutes just trying to close the loop in a different way by showing you a particular I/O-heavy program, rather than showing you Xmonad, whose I/O structures are somewhat complicated by their interaction with Xwindows. I'm going to show you a simpler I/O-rich application, because we spent the first hour and a half doing purely functional stuff, manipulating lists and so forth, and I want to show you the other half of Haskell programming, as it were. So I'm going to show you the script that we ran earlier to this QC thing, that takes a text file, gobbles it up, finds all the prop things, generates a script for GHCI to run, and runs GHCI. So that's just the kind of thing that you might use Perl or Python for. And Perl or Python would be perfectly fine for this application. I'm just going to show you doing that scripting application in Haskell. So here is the whole code for QC. And I'm just going to show you some of the pieces of it, rather than read it all off this big slide. So what does it do? Because it shows up some interesting points about this, how you write I/O-ish programs. So main, first thing to notice is that main has type I/O unit. This is the place where things finally get performed. The main program, function main in module main, must have type I/O unit. And to run the program is to perform this single action. So if you like, you can think of it, the business of the program is to construct one ginormous action that is then performed by some external agency. The result of the program is this I/O thing, which is then performed. So what does it do? Well, first of all, it calls getargs, which is a library function that gets you the argv as a list of strings. So the a's is now a list of strings, and then it calls process over those list of arguments. So these are typically going to be the file names in this QC application, right? This will be stack.hs, and maybe qc.hs as well. No, just stack.hs, actually. So A's, that's really the list of file names. Now, what am I doing here? The map M underscore. Ooh, what's that? Well, what's process going to do? Process is going to do something effectful to each of the files. It's effectful because it's going to write stuff into the script file. So the effectful thing it does, process, is the first argument of mapm. So mapm underscore, the underscore is part of the name, right? It's just a trailing underscore. And it has type A to IOB, so it takes a value, it takes a function from values to actions, right? And it applies this function to each element of a list to get a bunch of actions, and then it composes those actions together in sequence and does them one after the other. So, to take a particular example, if I applied mapm of f to a list x1 to xn, that would be the same as saying do f of x1 and then f of x2 and then f of x3 down to f of xn and finally return unit. So that is, apply the function to each of the x's in turn, and so that's like a for loop, right? It says, for file name in A's, do process is another way to think of it. That's what mapm does. Does that make sense? Yeah.
It's ordered, right?
But it's what?
You have to follow that order.
In the order of the list. That's the specification of mapm. Yes.
Is that also called list comprehension?
No. This guy is not. I'm going to show you list comprehension in a second, but this guy is just a function. In fact, I'm going to show you his definition. Am I going to show you mapm's definition? No, I'm not going to show you mapm's definition. But you can write mapm just by pattern matching on the list. Mapn on the entry list is return unit. Mapn on, x colon x's is, well, do f of x, and then mapn f over the x's. So it's very simple to write mapm. Exercise for the reader, and you can look up the answer in the library. Okay. So now what are we going to? What does process do? Process takes a file name, here it is, a string, and does whatever's necessary for that file name. And what is it going to do? Well, it's going to read the contents of the file. So this process starts like this. Takes the file name here, calls read file, which takes the string, which is the file name, and reads the file, so it's got an IO type, and returns what? The entire contents of the file as a string, right? So there's a string that's the whole contents of the file. Now we process the contents of the file with a purely functional way. GetTests just takes a string, that is the contents of the file, and produces a list of strings, that is all the prop underscore things that were defined in that file. Right? So that's a pure function. No IO here. Do you see the difference? This is the sort of important point that I'm trying to bring out by doing this example, is that functions tell you whether they do IO or not, and quite a lot of the heavy lifting is done by functions that don't do any IO at all. You tend to keep the IO localized, and then this is pure guy, because he just takes a long string and extracts all the prop underscore bits from it. Okay? Oh, at least not okay, you're not going to, yeah, yes.
Can you use that first guy name expression?
This guy?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, you see, what would happen if I said get tests of read file? Good question. What would happen? Question for the alert audience. If I wrote get tests of read file, what happens? The IO will get passed to get test as well as the file. Well, let's look at get test. Get test takes as its argument a string. And what's the type of read file of file? It's IO string. And so the type checker says, I need a string. I've got an IO string. Game over. Right? It's like sort of giving an int where you need a character, giving a boolean where you need a float. It just says this is incompatibly typed. So the type checker rejects the program on the grounds that he needs a string and you're giving it an IO string. Yeah. How did this arrow... This arrow is the bit that changes it. The typing rule for do notation is the thing on the right is an I.O. thing, and the thing on the left is just the thing part of the I.O. thing, right? So if this is I.O. string, this is string, right? Because remember the pictures here. GetLine has type I.O. string, but the value that you get out of GetLine is just the string part.
Why can't you do get tests of arrow read file file?
Ah, right. So you could imagine something that some extra notation around the in the argument here, so sort of said somehow get tests, something like this that said, and indeed people suggest doing doing something like that. But that's not the way Haskell is today. Remember that the dishevelling rules I gave for do notation were extremely simple. This would make it significantly more complicated to say what you mean by, you know, which do is it attached to. So it's part of the relentless sort of relentless period. It's not that you couldn't imagine something a little bit more convenient. Yeah.
So I guess my motivation was getting rid of that CTS. So I guess maybe if you use a non-syndemption, the bind operator.
Oh yes, you could say read file a file, bind, get tests or something. Yes, but yeah, you could. Yeah, but in fact, naming it isn't necessarily a bad thing. But do notation certainly forces you to name things quite often. Yeah. Okay. Moving on quickly on. What do we get now? So this is process file. Here's the top bit, is the bit we've just been looking at. And then the rest of process one file, what do we do? Well, test, remember, is the list of prop things that we found in the file. We haven't seen the function get test yet. And what do we want to do? If there's nothing found in the file, if it's null, so null takes a list of A to Boolean, it says, is the list empty? Right? Is it nil? Then we can just print out a complaint. Otherwise, we can write into a file called script. And now what are we going to write into the file called script? Well, what we want to put in a file called script is this. Load stack.hs, putstra, what do we want to do? That's right. So we want to print on the screen. When this script is run through GHCI, it'll load stack.hs, it'll print proprev, it'll then run QuickCheck, it'll then print propfocus, and then run propfocus. So this is the output we want to put into the script file, right? Before we finally run down at the bottom here, we run GHCI. So we run GHCI by just calling system, which says run a system process. GHCI dash V0 says be less verbose, left arrow script. So this just says feed this to a shell, right? And script is the name of the file that we built here. And how do we build the file? Well, the first line of the file is colon L. That's the load stack.hs. File, remember, is the file name. So we loaded the file. And then there's a bunch of make test things. So we build this script by doing something with one for each test. All right. So I have that sort of feeling in the air that saturation point is nigh. So I'm not going to inflict upon you the further details of make tests and so forth, I'll tell you my sort of my top level story, which was that this little script, short as it is, nicely illustrates the way in which you can have an imperative program, right? This is the whole program that contains within it some fairly significant purely functional parts that do quite a lot of work, right? So the this is the get test thing that is the composition of a bunch of, well, it divided the lines, lexit, take the head, take the first, filter, take is prefix of, nub, and so forth. And so there's quite a lot of purely functional work going on. And I was going to, but you can absorb that lesson without looking at the details. And should you feel motivated later, you can look at the details. But they're not actually terribly demanding. Okay.
May I do it in the bathroom?
You can even do it in the bathroom, yes, yes. Though at this point you probably would need a bit of paper to look at, and so it might get wet. So what to say here? Haskell script. So you can write these sort of lightweight scripting programs in Haskell pretty well. You don't even need to have a compiler. This run Haskell things means you can just run it just like you can Perl, and you can push the bang hash thing at the, is it hash bang or bang hash? Hash bang at the top of your file. It'll work just fine. So you can do all those kind of scripty things. But it's a strongly typed language, which I think is good because it catches many errors. You pay your money and you take your choice. Go ahead and use Perl if you like. But the point really I was making here was not so much that, you know, strongly typed and therefore wonderful. It's that in the program that I've shown you so far, there are lots of non-handled error conditions that I haven't shown you, as is very common in quick and dirty scripts. But of course, just because it's written in Haskell doesn't save you from the pain of having to think about, you know, what to do if there are too many tests or not enough, or they weren't called prop underscore, or all the other horrible things that could go wrong when you write a quick and dirty script. But we've also learned a bit about libraries. So I used various libraries in doing that. Right? I kept putting up little boxes with auxiliary functions in libraries. And Haskell has a fairly respectable collection of libraries, regular expressions and HTTP libraries and database connections and GUI bindings, all those kind of good things. Not on the scale of mainstream languages, but nevertheless very, very much better than we had a few years ago. And they're growing rather rapidly. Yeah. There is, actually, yes. It's called Hackage. I'm going to show you a little picture of it later. So there's a CPAN-like collection, which has, 100-odd packages available on it at the moment, I think. The other thing I want to tell you, just in case you have managed to get this far and not quite absorb this message yet, is the types tell the story. Sort takes a list of companies and gives a list of companies and doesn't do I.O. Sort by share price, saying, go and look up the share price on the stock exchange, must do I.O., and that shows up in the type. So the types tell the story, and this is important. That's the message I want to get over here. So I think of Haskell as the world's finest imperative programming language, because it has this way in which you can write imperative programs without them polluting the functional piece. In other words, you don't have to throw the baby out with the bathwater. It's not as convenient in the imperative bit as writing in an imperative language, but you do have this kind of, I think of the type system as like a kind of plastic seal that just keeps the I.O. stuff separate from the functional stuff. And I do think that in the long term that's very important. The other important thing is that actions are first class values. The MapM we saw was one example, but here's a slightly simpler example. Let's take repeatN. So repeatN is like a for loop. It takes an integer and an I.O. action, and it repeats this action n times. So repeat of 0 in an action does nothing. Repeat of n in an action does the action. And then, oh, I should have said do. Do a semicolon repeat n minus 1. Right? So it's the important thing here is that that this action is just an argument. It's just a value that's passed. So the way I think of it is like user-defined control structures. Rather than just being provided with for and while and until and those kind of things, you can just program up your own ones to suit your particular application. Yeah. Why is what? Repeat.
Repeat n.
Oh, because it has an I.O. argument.
But why do you have an I.O. argument?
Oh, well, if it didn't, what argument could it have? Repeat n int to what? Int to something?
Oh, it's I.O. because it's sequential?
It's I.O. because it has an effect, right? It's repeat n. The reason for doing it n times is because it does something in an imperative sense. It launches the missiles. Launch the missiles 10 times, please. Right? If you want to say compute 3 10 times, you get 3 every time. So you probably don't want to do that. Right? So does that?
Well, I'm thinking of something like say take the n elements from a list. You could split the head off the list n times, and then you
yes.
That nth element.
Yes.
You're not doing any
That's perfectly true. Yes, you can. If you have a function from t to t, where t is a type, you could indeed say you could have repeats with the following type, a different sort of repeat. In fact, I think it might be called iterate. I think there is such a function in the prelude. Repeat iterate with type int to and an a to a function, and it gives an a to a function. And so iterate 3 of f will be f composed with f composed with f. That's what you mean, isn't it? So that's like tail. Yeah. Taking the tail of a list would have that property. So yes, indeed. Good point. Thank you for clarifying that. You're absolutely right. But that's rather different here, because if you couldn't use this repeat on this guy, right? Because he's not an a to a function. He's an I.O. computation. So you couldn't use the same repeat. Okay, so there you are. So the message here is first-class actions. Actions as first-class values is an additional advantage of keeping the pure and imperative world separate. From function interface, you mentioned. And it's exactly handled in an I.O.-like way. So here is the import that imports X map window, which does some mysterious thing that I neither know nor care about. But it has a C type rather like this. It takes a display, which is a pointer to a display, and a pointer to a window. And in Haskell, you say foreign import, so import says suck it in, C-call, this gives it a calling convention. Unsafe says it doesn't garbage collect or block, so you can generate fast but unsafe code for the call. So it's a promise about the nature of the C function, which is not checked. And then there's what it's called in C and which header file you need, and then you give it Haskell type. And so more or less, this is a way in which you can import any old C function. Yes? Stud call, I think we have. P call, I don't think so. But in principle, you know, we could add whatever was necessary. I think C call and stud call are the only ones we have at the moment. Oh, you mean which C call?
P call.
I haven't a clue. So at the moment, the good thing about C is everybody knows what it is. So you can say, you want to call Python? Call C, and then you can call from C to Python. I'm now going to switch into skipping mode again, because those of you who are on the ball will know that the easy bit is getting to call the function. The hard bit is marshalling the data, right? Because the data types don't match up. C types look very unlike Haskell types. So for some things, like just pointers, it's pretty easy. So an addr hash is a built-in Haskell type that just represents a C pointer. Haskell doesn't mess with it. It just doesn't touch those bits. It just treats it as some bits that it must hang on to. And so you can wrap it up in a data type like this. Display is muck display of addr hash, a constructor with a single argument. And then this is automatically wrapped and unwrapped by the foreign import statement. But it's not so easy when you have things like pointers to buffers. And then so x get event, x next event is a good example. The x function for next event takes a display and an event pointer, a pointer to a record which is filled in by x next event in a completely side effecty kind of way. So you supply an empty record, x next event fills it in, and then you get it back, and now you can look at it. That's very un-Haskell-like, right? What you really want, you want a function with type, display to IO of x event. That is, you give it a display, and you get back an event. And what is an event? It's a record with a constructor for each different possible kind of event. So this is a Haskell data type declaration. So how do you get from here, this x next event, to this nice Haskell-friendly event? Well, the answer is very painfully, right? So it's always depressing, this marshalling business. But how does next event work? Well, you've got to allocate one of those C records, call the real C function using the foreign import, and then laboriously peek into the C world, you know, a word at a time, fetching out, you know, 3 bytes from 7 byte offset from here, and gingerly picking them out. That's these peek operations are unpacking the record one field at a time and constructing a Haskell record. It's very dismal. Fortunately, there are tools that will do this for you. Right, so all these red bits are the sort of hard offsets. So it's painful to write this by hand. There are tools to automate it, but they're not part of the language. They're separate tools. So that's really all I wanted to say for that. But this is always the case with FFIs. The only question is how well hidden it is. And there's really just a mismatch between the type systems, and that's all, you know, all you can say. Now, the last 15 minutes I want to say is just a sort of quick skate over some of the bits that I haven't talked about at all. So this is a sort of light, so you can relax now. Everything is going to be easy and light. Just want to say, laziness first is something that I have not mentioned at all, hardly. Right? So strange, as you might have thought of Haskell as being primarily a lazy language. So it is. So the thing about a lazy language is that neither functions nor data constructors evaluate their arguments until they're needed. So that means you can write a function like cond. So it works like this. Cond true takes two other arguments. Cond true of t returns t and false returns e. Right. So that's the then and the else branches. So this is like an if coded up in Haskell. And I've called it cond. So you couldn't write this in a call-by-value language because it would evaluate both the then part and the else part, which isn't very good, right? So this is rather like C's question mark operator, except the question mark operator is built in and cannot be turned into a C function because you don't want to evaluate both the then and the else parts, because if you evaluate them both, you probably get a seg fault because the condition is saying, you know, if the value is not equal to zero and so forth. But in Haskell, it's lazy, and so you perfectly well can. And so that's another way in which you get better modularity, because you can abstract as ordinary functions stuff which otherwise has to be built in. Here's another example. It's very convenient programming with laziness because you can make little bindings here. This where clause binds a value called negx, but it's only used in one of these branches. But it doesn't matter that it's only used in one branch. It'll only get evaluated if that branch is used. right, rather than having to worry about pushing it near the places it's used. You just write down long lists of definitions which all depend on each other, knowing that only the ones that are important will get used. Okay, yeah.
So might you say that the whole language short circuits everything, like...
Yes, do short circuits, like, so is this what you mean by short circuiting?
Yeah.
So here's a Boolean OR.
Well, I was thinking of the conditional operator in C, where it's short circuited.
Oh, right. The question mark only evaluates one thing. Yeah. Yes, and indeed, there is a short circuiting AND as well, isn't there? So if the first is true, then the second is not. So here's the way it works in Haskell: short circuiting OR says if the first branch is true, well, the result is true, and you don't evaluate the second guy at all. So it's automatically short circuiting. I'm going to skip this. So the thing about laziness is that it's a very powerful aid to modularity, because it turns out that you can often take a program that you would have to write in an entwined way and write it instead in a separate modular way. Here's an example. Imagine that you're doing a game-playing program. You've got a board, a setup, and you want to compute your next move. Well, one way to do it is to generate an infinite or perhaps very large tree of possible moves, right, to 20 plies, and then explore that tree to find, you know, in a mini-max kind of way, to find which move you'd like to make. In a call-by-value language, that wouldn't be on, because you'd occupy too many gigabytes on the big tree. But in a lazy language, you can separate the generate from the explore and prune part of the algorithm. And it turns out that's quite a common pattern that's, in fact, shown on this slide that I don't have time to show you. That there it is. See? You can look at it. This is that previous slide is easy stuff. You won't even need the bath to help you. But the message I want to get across is modularity. Laziness is not just a sort of cute trick. It actually helps you to build modular programs. And it does this by sort of unifying data with control. The short-circuiting bit we discussed is normally thought of as a what happens to the program counter thing, and here it's what happens to the data. It's a funny way. Control and data kind of blur into each other in Haskell. And most important single thing about laziness turned out to be that laziness prevented us from going to the dark side and having side effects for doing I.O. And so we had this prolonged period of embarrassment before we invented that I.O. type constructor that I showed you. So that's its real usefulness. All right. Here's a bunch of things I'm not going to talk about at all, except just to mention their names. There's lots more stuff about type system that I haven't mentioned. These are all good keywords you will find if you look at in tutorials about Haskell. There's metaprogramming extensions to Haskell and domain-specific ways of extending the compiler by adding rewriting rules. Then on the sort of library end, I mentioned a bit about monads, which is a sort of generalization of this I.O. mechanism to make it general in a a lot more general. And monad transformers transform one monad into another, and arrows are still more mind-bendingly general. But all of this is library stuff. That's what's amazing. It's not built in. So, you know, you can take it. You don't have to have it. There's a lot of work being done on generic programming. So this is when you've got one program that you want to work over a variety of different data types. There are lots of exciting stuff being done there. On the parallelism side, for a long time we've had concurrent Haskell that takes that I.O. idea and spawns lots of threads. So instead of having one sequential flow of I.O. control, you can have many threads of I.O. running simultaneously. So now the program is non-deterministic, because each thread might be reading and writing files independently, and they better not screw each other up in the usual kind of not screwing each other up for parallelism way. So how do the threads communicate and synchronize? Using software transactional memory, which is what I shall be speaking about on Wednesday morning. For only 15 minutes, I have to speak very, very fast. So that's sort of multi-threading stuff, right, where the program is by design non-deterministic. Then there's just exploiting multicores, and you'd like to stay pure and parallel as much as possible. So there, for that, you want data parallelism. And again, I'm giving a talk on Wednesday afternoon, I think, on nested data parallelism in Haskell, which describes how to do quite a powerful form of data parallelism as an extension to Haskell. So there's lots more stuff still in the language area. And then outside that skin comes the sort of Haskell ecosystem, which has sprouted a lot recently, of interpreters and compilers, which I've already mentioned, bunches of libraries of all sorts that I've mentioned, but also particularly to do with testing and coverage testing. I'm going to show you, where's coverage testing? Here's coverage testing. So this is a library called the Haskell Program Coverage Tester, which Andy Gill, who's somewhere sitting around here, there he is, he's over there, wrote. So this does some, this instruments your program and then shows you which bits, how much code coverage you've got. And you can guess what this means. Green is good and red is bad as far as code coverage. And he'll even show you nice little, your source code annotated with marks to show which bits have not been executed. So you then get a clue about what quick check tests you should write to exercise the bits of the code that you haven't tested. Then there's profiling, space and time profiling. That's what this is doing. So this tells you stuff about where the space and time is going. That's really important in a lazy language. It can be quite difficult to figure out where the time is going, and even more difficult to figure out where the space is going. So this is space profiling. This here is time, and the vertical axis is space, and the colors are different bits. What these ones are, I think these are different data constructors, but you can ask it to say, profile it by what kind of thing is filling up the heap, and you can also profile by who produced the thing that is filling up the heap. So they're quite good tools for debugging the space and time behavior in your program. Then there are lots of generators, parser generators, Lexer generators, FFI generators, as I discussed a little bit before. Let's see, documentation generation. So we haven't looked very much at source code, in fact, but you can, thought I'd just show you the paddock documentation for our program. Where is, yes, so here, this this code here, these little vertical bars say, say that here begins some markup that describes the code that follows. So it's a bit like Java doc, right? It's markup embedded in the code, and then you, and I'm not, I don't know how to get my desktop back at short notice, so I can't show you the HTML. So it generates nice little sort of web pages that show you what your package is like. And then packaging and distribution is really important for distributing libraries. And again, we're sort of slowly catching up with the state of the art. But things have moved on a lot recently. So there's now the packaging mechanism is called Cabal. And the website where you get with this equivalent to CPAN is called Hackage. And it kind of looks like this. So here's Hackage. So these are all the stuff that it has. Does it give a total? It doesn't give a total. There's a whole bunch of packages, and they're just listed by function here. And the idea is, it's the usual kind of thing. When you download a package, you get a package comes with a cabal file, which describes what's in it, and what version it is, and what other packages it depends on, in the usual kind of way. And it comes up with a build program, or a script that tells you how to build it. And that is, of course, a Haskell program. And so you run the Haskell program, and you say, you know, configure, build, and install. And this is typically a very small Haskell program, because its data is here, and it typically just imports a library. I'll show you the Xmonad, where are we? Here's the Xmonad cabal file. So this is the description of the package, which gives you, it says what it is and what category it is and who the maintainer is and what it depends on. That's really important, which other packages it depends on, and so forth. And then the setup script is this. Oh, it's really short. So it's only the hash bang thing followed by import distribution.simple, which is imports from the cabal library a particular module, which exports a function called default main. So this script just says main equals default main. So it just says do whatever distribution.simple does. And distribution.simple is a cabal library that understands that cabal file I just showed you and does the right thing. So Xmonad doesn't have any exceptional stuff to do. But if you have exceptional stuff to do, well, then you can ignore cabal altogether and just write Haskell code that does the right thing, whatever that might be. Okay, so where are we? 7 minutes to go. And we're in good shape. I just wanted to stand a bit further back and give you my sort of kind of perspective of what's going on with all this Haskell stuff. So here it is. Here is SLPJ's categorization of the world of programming. We have, on the vertical axis, we have useless languages at the bottom and useful languages at the top, and dangerous languages on the left and safe languages on the right. Right? So languages which permit arbitrary effects are dangerous because it's difficult to get programs right when any procedure can do anything at any time to any other procedure. And it's, on the other hand, if you have a program that has no effect at all, then it's really not very useful. So Where we'd like to be is in languages that are both safe and useful. So there's two things going on at the moment, right? Because in some ways, no one's in the place we would like to be in the end. Plan A is to move in this direction and to try to control effects, and plan B is to start from the no effect situation and creep up. You see, we're just motivated by envy here, right? Because we're in this language which has, you know, very limited effects, and we look enviously at our, you know, at our pearl friends who are busy getting the job done, and think, well, how could we do that without selling our soul to the devil? See, so it's very, very, very productive. But there is lots of work going on in this direction as well. For example, this is the give control effects. There's lots of work on, for example, regions and ownership types that tries to limit the scope of effects that particular, you know, so one program owns a value, and that means that no other object can access. Like if an object has a field that contains a list, very often you know that it has the only pointer to that list, right? And that every embedded pointer within the list is also completely private. And ownership types try to formalize that idea so that you can prove that the object, when it has that list, actually has it. And if it gives that pointer to somebody else, then it doesn't have it and he does, right? So in a value-oriented world, you don't have to prove all that stuff. In an imperative world, you do. And so, these are all techniques for gradually controlling effects. And I think we'll see lots more work on the controlling effects angle. The vertical direction, starting with value-oriented programming and trying to become more useful, is not solely occupied by Haskell. There are actually quite a lot of domain-specific languages, like SQL and indeed Google's MapReduce thing, that have the same flavor of doing value-oriented stuff in a specific sense. Haskell is a very wide-spectrum language, though, and so it has a bigger job to do to get from the values to something useful. But that's the direction we're moving. So I like this picture because it doesn't suggest that, you know, anybody has the right answer from the beginning. We're all sort of heading towards a common goal, just from different directions. And we can learn from each other, right? So we learn, we have a sort of envy in this direction, and sometimes there's feedback in the other direction. So this stuff about software transactional memory illustrated both directions, because transactional memory started up here. Then Tim Harris and I transplanted it into Haskell and learnt a couple of new tricks that were exposed by doing it in Haskell that are now being retrofitted into the imperative world. So I think that's quite encouraging. So here we go. I think that this business about being serious about purity is really what, in the end, what Haskell has to give to the world. And it's good to have one group of sort of purists relentlessly pursuing Plan B, even while lots of work is going on Plan A. But I do think that increasingly we'll get growing checkable subsets appearing in imperative languages over the next few years, particularly as we become more concerned about parallelism. And I hope that having sort of knowing a bit more about the functional perspective on programming may actually make you a better imperative programmer. People often say that. If you read, there's lots of people are blogging about Haskell these days, and many of them are mainstream imperative programmers and say they've changed the way they write their imperative programs. You can get lots of information about Haskell readily on Haskell.org. Haskell.org is a wiki, so Haskell is a very open sourcey community. There is no master plan, there is no controlling mind. It's not in control of any company, certainly. And the whole of Haskell.org is a wiki, so you can go there and spam the front page if you like. But this I think is in your notes. You don't need to write these URLs down. But there's lots of good stuff, including lots of tutorials and books about Haskell. This is the wiki book, which is, I've just photographed a little bit of the screen about the wiki book to suggest that you get quite a lot more background material than I've given you in this tutorial if you're interested in following any of it up. There indeed is the front page of Haskell.org. So is there anything that I've sort of considered just in the last few minutes, we've sort of taken a more sort of general take on things. But has anybody got any other questions about Haskell itself, or indeed comments? Because you guys know an awful lot about programming, and I'd be very interested to know if you just have any general comments to make. You know, you don't have to phrase them in the form of a question. Yeah. What made us leave the other functional languages and work in Haskell? So this was, you know, back in 1989 or so. So at that stage, there were mainstream functional languages. So ML was well established, and Lisp was very well established. Those are both called by value languages. So the group of people that built Haskell were primarily motivated by laziness. We're very excited about laziness. I've tried to describe why I think that purity is ultimately more important. I don't think we realized that then. But that was our war cry. Laziness was our war cry. So we were all building different lazy languages, and we just got together to build one. On Haskell.org, you'd find a, under the history of Haskell up here, you'll find a 60-page epic paper about the history of Haskell, which some colleagues of mine and I wrote very recently for the History of Programming Languages conference, which was last month in San Diego. So it's an easy reading kind of paper, and you might enjoy taking a look at it. And it begins with quite a lot of anecdotal material about how Haskell got started. Yeah.
I'm curious if you feel there's a particular imperative language that's ahead of the curve in terms of purity and.
Ooh, is there an imperative language that's ahead of the curve in terms of purity? Ooh. I don't think any imperative language has yet grasped the nettle of trying to really rigorously encapsulate effects and set, and have a solid type system to say nothing could be effectful. So C# 3.0, I know a bit more about, has gained many functional features. So it contains a larger and larger functional subset. And indeed, Python contains a pretty large functional subset as well. So we're seeing bigger functional subsets, but always in the context of a language in which it's always possible that even within a function, you could call a side-effecting thing. There's no way of excluding that. Even within the functional subsets, you can do bad things, and it's not checked that you can't. So I think it's only when that nettle is grasped, which, you know, by a device like IO types, or some kind of analysis, or, you know, some compiler-supported analysis that says when things are pure, that's when I think I think that'll be a sort of Rubicon kind of moment. I wouldn't be surprised if it happens in the next, you know, 5 years or so, actually. But
in that.
So for me, it's a design goal for it to be usable as a mainstream language. So that's why I've spent a lot of the last 10 years, I suppose, trying to find the barriers that prevent it, like, you know, absence of concurrency or absence of FFI or weak IO or bad libraries, and trying to sort of knock them down serially to make it possible. And Haskell is being used for quite, you know, by quite a lot of companies. For example, Andy Gill here from Galwa. Galwa uses Haskell a great deal. They're right here in Portland. You might want to comment on that in a second. Here, do you want to say something quickly about Galwa while you're here?
The question is, can you make a living programming Haskell, or why are you here? Same question. I'm a professor in Haskell for 7 years for a company in Portland.
We have about 20 engineers, and we're desperate for Haskell engineers. So if anybody wants to talk to me afterwards, okay, you've only had a 3-hour tutorial, but at least it's a start.
we're
ahead of the curve, so. But we are desperate for engineers, but we also work closely with Simon and deeply appreciate the deep work that he's done bringing the GC compiler further and further along the curve.
But so the mainstream for me really means, you know, deep support on a, you know, it's just, you get an incredible amount of stuff when you program in C# or Java or Python, because there's such enormous support of libraries, and we don't, the community just isn't large enough to offer that at the moment. How to get over that hump, right, to that kind of mainstream, I don't know. And maybe Haskell never will. I'd be quite happy if the ideas made it over the hump, as it were. But I think it's not impossible. As I say, rather to my surprise, the graph has ticked up very sharply in the last few years. Been a lot more buzz. Yeah. Right, very good example. The only implementation of Perl 6 is in Haskell, because it's such a blooming complicated language that. So yes, and Darks, the revision control system, is written in Haskell. Those two projects, Darks and Pugs, have done a lot to sort of publicize Haskell to a wider community. So we're very grateful to the authors of those projects for doing it. Yes.
Isn't there also a web app framework, HAPS?
HAPS, yes. Alex Jacobson is responsible for HAPS, HAPS. I don't know very much about HAPS, but it certainly exists. He's put a lot of effort into it, and it's free software. I think it's readily available. Yes.
Could you say
something about typing, having used small talk. I've often hated strongly typed languages, and I'm not sure what the laziness has to do with any this lazy
lots of the RAM.
So I feel a bit in a sort of no-win situation here because for me, types are the way I think about writing the program in the first place. But I know that for other people, they sort of get in the way of getting their first program running, and they can feel quite an impediment. And so I don't quite know how to resolve that. For me, they're the thing that keeps me sane. JHC, my compiler, is 80 or 90,000 lines of Haskell, and yet but I'm confident that I can change a data type. Sometimes I just change the data type, the syntax trees of Haskell programs, and I type make. And typos start popping up. That tells me the consequential changes I need to make. I couldn't imagine being able to maintain GHC without types. So for me, types are crucial for maintainability of large-scale software. But I know that other people, and indeed, reasonable people who I respect, have a diametrically opposing view. And there's lots of... What can I say? There's lots of ways to look at the programming problem. But for me, it's fundamental. And they change the whole way you think about programming.